From the Gospel of John, chapter 3, verses 1 through 17. There was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a Jewish leader. He came to Jesus at night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could do these miraculous signs that you do unless God is with him." Jesus answered, "I assure you, unless someone is born anew, it's not possible to see God's kingdom." Nicodemus asked, "How is it possible for an adult to be born? It's impossible to enter the mother's womb for a second time and be born, isn't it?" Jesus answered, "I assure you, unless someone is born of water and the Spirit, it's not possible to enter God's kingdom. Whatever is born of the flesh is flesh, and whatever is born of the Spirit is spirit. Don't be surprised that I said to you, you must be born anew. God's Spirit blows wherever it wishes. You hear its sound, but you don't know where it comes from or where it is going. It's the same with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said, "How are these things possible?" Jesus answered, "You're a teacher of Israel and you don't know these things? I assure you that we speak about what we know and testify about what we have seen, but you don't receive our testimony. If I've told you about earthly things and you don't believe, how will you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has gone up to heaven except the one who came down from heaven, the human one. And just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so must the human one be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him will have eternal life. God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that everyone who believes in him won't perish, but will have eternal life. God did not send his son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him." For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, and for the word of God within us, we say, thanks be to God.
Oh,
reason. Remember we looked at what was different in here? Did you guys remember we noticed all the things that were different? How the colors up here are purple and the screen is purple because what? It's what season in the church? Lent. That's right. And what is Lent? What is it? Quiz time. Do you remember? 40 days before Easter. Very good. Did you guys get that down yet? Lent, 40 days before Easter. It's a time we're going to get our souls in shape. And last week, we planted a seed. Did you see it? Come look. Our belief, Keep us strong in our faith and help us do all we need to do to make our souls grow strong. We ask your blessing on these children, that you would keep them safe and bring them back next week to learn more about you. And all of God's children said, Amen. I invite you now to please pray for me as I pray for you. Let us pray. Most loving God, make your truth known for us this day. Lord, you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. All right, church, week two of boot camp. How are we feeling? How's your soul? Last week, we started this intense time of working on our souls by doing what you must do first, right? Admitting we need a change. Saying, yes, we want to be better Christians. We want to be true disciples of Christ. So we got started working out our souls and committed to help each other resist the temptation to give up when it gets hard. So we're here, we're together, and we're going to keep going. This week, we get the chance to take a good look in the mirror, to see our souls for what they really are. And we're given that opportunity in the story we read today from the Gospel of John. Reverend Deborah Kapp says, if any character in the Bible can be seen as representative of the 21st century Christians, it's Nicodemus, good old Nick. In many ways, he's a sympathetic character, successful, self-confident man. He has a leadership role in the community. He's clearly spiritually open and curious, yet also rational. So he approaches Jesus directly and is committed and curious enough to make an appointment with him, to talk face to face. But Nicodemus isn't ready to go public with his interest in Jesus. So he makes that appointment in the middle of the night, when he can keep his faith a secret, separate from the rest of his life. He's intrigued by Jesus, but he wants to compartmentalize whatever faith he has. Perhaps that sounds familiar. For too long and too many, church has been a place where we keep our faith here, keep it safe until we come back next week to check on it. I hope that we can all try to take our faith home with us this week and for the next several weeks. So this meeting between good old Nick and Jesus not only holds up a mirror for us to see our, maybe a part of ourselves in this story, but it also gives us, of course, the most famous Bible verse ever, John 3:16. And we get the very infamous, maybe, concept of being born again. Now, we've got to first recognize that this beautiful verse so many people hold dear often gets turned into what I call scripture bullets. It's lobbed at people. And this passage about being born anew, as Jesus says, can be used in some pretty awful ways. I think we've probably seen that, right? Reverend Ann Florence says, are you born again is really code language for are you saved like us, or are you crazy like them? It's either insider talk to judge another person's relationship with God, or it's outsider talk to label Christians as fanatics. Either way, using John 3:16 like this, along with the idea of being born again, relies on a stereotype of what it means to be a Christian. So this is important for us, particularly as we're working to be true disciples, because we don't just want to be some living stereotype. We want to really be following Jesus. For so many Christians, the whole gospel, their whole faith, their whole understanding of God is summed up in the words of John 3:16. Everyone who believes in Jesus won't perish, but will have eternal life. And that is fantastic. But the problem comes when we understand believing in Jesus to be simply something we do with our minds. Too often, we take this one verse totally out of context and use it to rationalize our comfortable, compartmentalized, passive faith. We hear it all the time. Just believe. Have faith. Accept Christ as your Savior. Period. There's never a follow-up to that encouragement. Because the problem is, if we just believe, that makes us only converts. It doesn't make us a disciple. Nicodemus believed, right? He said, clearly, Jesus, you must be sent from God. But he was no disciple. He wouldn't even be seen with Jesus during daylight. It's clear that for Jesus, being born again and believing in him weren't as much about what you do with your mind, but what you do with your heart and your life. If you keep reading past John 3:16, you'll hear Jesus say, first, he didn't come to condemn anyone, but to save the world. So let's not forget that. And he goes on in verse 21 to say, those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. For Jesus, believing and doing are inseparable. Being born again is about so much more than just holding a belief. Spiritual rebirth means a new start, a new way of life. And that's exactly what our boot camp for the soul is meant to trigger in us, a reset. The veterans I know have told me boot camp certainly leaves a lasting impression. It's meant to break you down as an individual and build you back up as a team. And certainly fitness boot camps that maybe the rest of us are more familiar with, if they're really going to be successful, they're meant to jumpstart you on a new way of life. It's not just a diet, which might bring some fast, short-term results. True health, as we all know, takes a lifestyle change. So in the same way, becoming spiritually strong can't be achieved through a six-week diet of giving something up. It's got to be a lifestyle change, a commitment to a new way of functioning, a way that aligns us more closely to the way God sees us. Jesus says a new beginning is possible. But we know, no matter how wonderful a new way of life might be, all new beginnings come from endings. Becoming a parent has been one of the greatest things to ever happen to me. Totally a new way of life, but it's meant that necessarily some things had to come to an end. like sleep. Or a sense of careless freedom. Those were great things. Now, would I trade that? No, but those things had to come to an end. The 90s song was right. Every new beginning comes from some other beginning's end. Any lifestyle change means giving things up. Usually things we like. And it means putting them away for good. This change that boot camp brings means leaving behind old habits, prejudices, and weaknesses. This is what Jesus means when he tells Nicodemus that he must be born anew. And good old Nick, he thinks for a minute, wait, this isn't really possible, is it? No, Nicodemus, Jesus isn't trying to send us back to the womb. But Reverend Winnie Varghese wonders, can we crawl back to a place of innocence and openness where we are ultimately vulnerable and dependent? Can we try and see the world anew? Can we be reformed, reordered, or rebuilt to love more, forgive more, and demand more? The path to being a better disciple, a better follower of Jesus, starts when we allow God to reset our lives and guide our daily choices. It means making seemingly small but permanent changes to how we live. To achieve physical health, a lot of people have started giving up things for good, right? Like bread or grains. Or some choose meat or sugar. They just remove it from their diets. Some people add something, a mandatory exercise time, to their schedules. So what do we need to give up or add permanently to be better Christians? Maybe gossip? Speaking negatively of others? Or maybe you need to add a mandatory time of prayer to your day or week. I know I need to give up the censor that I sometimes find on my faith. I need to talk about God more with people outside of church. You probably already know what it is that will make your soul healthier. Now we just gotta do it. Last week, everybody got one of these with our baptismal vows on there, and there's still some left if you didn't get one. This is a great place to start. And we said we were going to look at pieces of this vow each week. And so the first part of our vow that was made at our baptism says that we will renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of our sin. I'll tell you, I could do better at these. I might pray every day and thank God each time I pray, but do I repent of my sin? Do I ask forgiveness each day? Not usually. I may reject the evil powers of this world in my mind and with my mouth, but do my actions still fall into the traps of consumerism and prejudice and doubt? You bet. We all have these things that we just keep doing over and over again without thinking, that we know that they're not good for our souls. So how can we allow God today to reset us again? Can we be born anew once more and leave our bad soul habits behind? See, that's the thing with being born again. We aren't just born again once. We're born again and again and again. John Vandalar says in his prayer, Born Yet Again, why do we settle, O God, for only being born once or even twice? As if the world never changes, as if everything is just fine the way it is, and we have no need for a new life, new encounters with you, new promptings of your spirit, and new awakenings in our soul. Why do we turn your invitation into a mark of our own achievement, as if your life is anything other than an extravagant gift? As if the glimpses of your reign that we receive are earned or deserved or make us somehow better than others. We praise you for the shocking, miraculous truth, God, that we can always be, that we need to always be born again. That daily you welcome us into a surprising new life, the wonderful, creative, unpredictable world of your spirit. And that all we can do is allow ourselves to be pushed, birthed by your grace into new experiences of your reign. Here we are, O God. Let us be once more, in this moment, in this place, born yet again. Amen.